whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells.
How abundant are the good things that you have stored up for those who fear you, that you bestow in the sight of all, on those who take refuge in you.
And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work.
Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Let's pray. Lord, we come to you. We thank you for this day and the beauty of it. Lord, we thank you for our time. Lord, we just thank you for the ability to gather. Lord, we thank you for, God, what the Word tells us, that we are not just to survive but to thrive in the power of the name of Jesus Christ. And God, I thank you for our kids. I thank you for our adult choir, our youth that will be leading us in song. Lord, we ask that you will just continue to work in our midst. God, be with our time together this morning, glorified in all things. We'll be careful to give you the praise, honor, and glory for it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm anxious, and my notes are sitting out there, so if I forget an announcement, I'm sorry on that. If you are a guest, we're glad that you're here. Thankful that you're able to be a part of Flowood Baptist Church this morning. I apologize for my kids acting the way that they did, but that's what happens, I guess, in the world in which we live. But we're thankful that you're here. If you are a guest, you probably received a worship guide when you came in. There's a tear-off section there on the right side. If you have any questions about our church, you can fill that out. We'll try to answer any questions that you may have. Immediately following the service this morning will be a fall festival meeting. If you're helping in any way or in any capacity, if you could stay here in the sanctuary immediately following our service this morning, I would appreciate that very much. Also tonight, we are hosting the Rankin County Baptist Associational meeting. It starts at 5 o'clock. There will be preaching. There will be singing. There will also be a time of business, but it is a church service. We're not canceling church. We are not having discipleship training, but we will be having church. So you're welcome to come, be a part of that, starting at 5 o'clock. Other than that, I don't have any other announcements. Jerry Turner, our chairman of deacons, has an announcement he needs to make, and then we're going to turn it back over to Brother Keith and the choir.
Morning, everybody. Most of y'all know that the month of October is our pastor appreciation month. So, and I think most of you will agree that we have a really good ministerial staff here at Flowood Baptist Church. So with that being said, starting today, over the next few weeks, if you would like to contribute, we're taking up money for our ministerial staff. You'll have the opportunity today, next Sunday, and the following Sunday, if you want to give. If you do give, on your envelope, designate pastor appreciation with the amount. If you'd like to give online, the same thing, choose pastor appreciation when you do that. We'll do that for the next 3 weeks, and then on the last Sunday of the month, we'll present the monies that we've collected to them. Thank you very much.
Today's service is a little bit different, right? Yep. So it's something that we're calling a multi-generational service. We're so glad that you're here with us. We're so glad that you joined us this morning. So glad for these kids that are here this morning. And they're going to lead us in worship. Miss Paula's going to lead them on the guitar. And if you would, listen prayerfully. Stand and join us this morning. The kids are going to join us on the first verse of Holy.
Merciful and mighty. come to you this morning, Lord, just to gather together and praise you as a whole group of believers, Father. Father, we have so many heavy hearts this morning, Lord, and we just lift each and every one of them up to you, Lord. We lift Lori up to you. Lord, love her as only you can. Father, this world is really a sad place right now. And Lord, your word tells us that soon and very soon you're going to come and gather your children up. God, that's going to be in a twinkling of an eye. And Lord, I know there are so many people right now in this place that don't need to wait till that twinkling of an eye, for it may never come for them. God, if there's a decision to be made this morning, please press on someone's heart that needs to make that decision. And please just make them realize it's got to be today, Lord. It can't be wait and see. Because God, being in heaven with you is the most glorious thing anyone as a Christian could ever want to do. God, I pray now as we take these tithes and offerings, Lord, I pray you will bless them and use them for the furtherment of your kingdom. These things I ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
and new, that every song must end, and you never do.
So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. So that I have is a
Amen. I appreciate the kids and the youth and the choir being willing to do that, and the effort and the practice that has been taking place over the last several weeks in preparation for that this morning. This morning we're going to look at a subject entitled The Power of the Eyes in Ephesians chapter 1. If you have your Bible, we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 1, looking at the power of the aisles. I want to start this morning with a simple question that's kind of going to lay the outline of the answers or the reasoning and the subject matter that we're going to talk about. And the question is simply this: what are you going to do with the power granted to you from God? What are you going to do with the power granted to you from God? Now, many of you would say that you believe in the power of the name of Jesus. You believe that he can raise the dead. You believe that he can heal the sick. You believe that he can allow the dumb to speak and the blind to see and the deaf to hear. We would say that we believe in the power of Jesus Christ, as in the name of Jesus Christ, which the Bible says is higher than any other name, right? And at that name, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. But the problem is, many times we don't want to change the way that we view things. We want to look at it our way. We want to look at it through the carnal mind, the fleshly mind, the fleshly mindset, instead of looking at it the way that God desires us to see those things. And so when we understand the power of the eyes, we have to allow the eyes to be transformed by the power of the gospel. And therefore, we possess what we call kingdom authority. Kingdom authority is simply a divinely authorized right and privilege granted to all Christians to be able to walk through the spiritual life and claim victory to the spiritual things in the midst of the earthly disasters. Kingdom authority is a divine right authorized by God to Christians. And if we believe in the power that's in the name of Jesus Christ, then we believe that we have that right to be under the lordship of Jesus Christ, to be under his feet, to do what he's called us to do. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 18, if you have your Bible, says it this way: the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of the calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. This morning, I would like for us to clarify our sight line. You know, it's amazing to me that folks who won't ever sit on the front row or the second row or the third row, you let that baby get on the platform and they're going to be sitting at the altar, right? They're going to be right there. Kathy Pollard told me, do not block my sight. And so I didn't sit there. She's not in here now, so I'm going to pick on her as I was trying not to hyperventilate when mine was up here doing circles and the other one screaming without shoes on. But the idea is, hey, this is where we are. We're gonna change our sight line. So this morning, I want you to think about it like this, that we're going to change the way that we view things. We're going to change the way that we view ourselves. We're going to change the way that we see our self-worth. We're going to change the way that we see circumstances. We're going to change the way that we think about things. And when we do that, we need to realize something very important. Many of us are trying to clean the glasses that we are wearing instead of putting on new glasses. In other words, we are trying to keep the fleshly glasses on, and we're trying to wipe off the smudge of depression. We're trying to wipe off the smudge of anxiety. We're trying to wipe off the smudge of self-worth. We're trying to wipe off the smudge of pornography or alcoholism. We're trying to wipe the smudge off, but as we really need new glasses. But we as Christians so many times want to say that we love Jesus and we're sold out to Jesus and we believe in the power of Jesus, but we want to continue to wear the same glasses. So this morning, I want to challenge you to change your glasses. I want to challenge you to realize that if you are a believer this morning, you don't need to be wearing the glasses that you were wearing prior to Jesus, that you have a new pair of glasses on. So let's begin by looking at our first point, and it's simply, our eyes must be open. Our eyes must be open. We need to start seeing things the way that Christ wants us to see them. We need to realize that we will see them clearly when we begin to submit our lives and our actions and our thoughts to Jesus Christ. Verse 15 of Ephesians chapter 1. If you have your Bible, this is where we're going to really dive into. Paul's writing to the church of Ephesus, and he begins this way: wherefore I also, and I heard of the faith in the Lord of Jesus and love unto all the saints. In other words, you are a believer. You know what's going on. I've heard about your faith that's in Christ Jesus. Verse 16, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Paul's praying for the church of Ephesus. Verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of time. In other words, he's going to give you a new new set of glasses. He's going to give you a new mindset. And then verse 18, as we've already read, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of the calling and what is the riches of the glory of His inheritance to the saints. You see three things in these verses of Scripture. In verses 15 and 18, Paul prays that they will apprehend what they have. In verse 17, Paul prays that he will be given a spirit of wisdom and revelation. And then verse 18, Paul prays that your eyes will be open to the understanding, that they will see what's happening, they will accept the spirit of the revelation of God, and they will do what needs to be done so that we can possess the power in the name of Jesus Christ. And not only that, look at what verse 18 says in the latter part. It simply says that, and what is the riches of the glory and the inheritance of the saints? In other words, you are worth something in the eyes of Jesus. You matter. Your situation may be difficult. Your circumstances may be difficult. But the power that's in the gospel tells us that He has an inheritance for you that is far greater than you can ever imagine if you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Now this morning, let me make it clear. You have to know Jesus as your Savior to understand the inheritance. You have to know Jesus as your Savior to understand the riches of glory. You have to know Jesus as your Savior to know that when He calls you home, you're going to spend eternity in a place called heaven, that there is an inheritance for you that is greater than anything else. We think about inheritance so many times when a loved one passes away. Hey, what am I going to get, right? Am I going to get this? Am I going to get that? I remember my grandmother died. This is going to sound weird to you, but I wanted her pillowcase. My grandmother's pillowcase was some kind of silky, weird fabric. I don't know what it is, but I wanted that, and you'd have thought my family thought I was crazy that I wanted that particular thing, but I do. I use it most every night. I obviously wash it, Peter, but I use it most every night, and that's what I wanted from my grandmother because it meant something to me. And when we understand that inheritance mindset, we want and we grasp and we desire, you know, when this person passes, we get this, or that person passes, we get that. But we need to realize that from a spiritual mindset right now, that if we are spiritually poor, if you're sitting here this morning, if you are spiritually poor, that means that you don't know how to withdraw. And what that means is this. Those of y'all who have kids, your kids who are old enough know how to work a debit card, don't they, Dr. Atkins? You'd probably agree with that. Hey, Dad, can I borrow your credit card? I doubt he just hands it over. But if he does, they don't need to know how to do that, right? They can tap it. They can insert it. They can do all these things now. But if you're spiritually poor this morning, you don't know how to withdraw. So if you're a lost person this morning and you're spiritually poor, you need to realize the inheritance that's there before you right now. And that is, you need to withdraw from the King of Kings, your eternal life found in Jesus, so that you can experience the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's step one. Step two, if you are a believer this morning and you are struggling and you're hurting and you don't know where to go, don't go to the self-help books in the library. Go to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Go to the source. Go to the one that will give you what you need. As a Christian, I think we forget that. I think we forget the riches of the glory. I think we forget the inheritance that's before us. I think we forget the reward that we're going to receive when we put our faith and trust in Jesus and we spend eternity in a place called heaven, and that the power of the gospel is real. The word of God is inerrant. It is pure and it's powerful, and we often turn to different things. You know why many people don't believe in the power of the word of God? It's because we've allowed pesticides to get on the word of God. You know, if you ever eat organic food, some of y'all do, some of y'all don't. You eat organic food, you know, it's natural this, it's natural that. When the pesticides get on the food, it's no longer natural, it's no longer organic. And that's what's happening in our churches today. We're allowing the pesticides of the world to infiltrate our church, to infiltrate the gospel, to infiltrate the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we think that that nullifies the word of God. Let me tell you that pesticides on a fruit may not allow it to be organic, but pesticides of the world on the word of God does not change the power of the word of God. It does not change it from one thing to another. It remains the same. No matter what we do, no matter what we say, it doesn't change. And so the knowledge of man tries to nullify the wisdom of God. And we as people, as Christians, allow that to happen so many times when in reality we need to understand verse 3 of Ephesians chapter 1. And it says, blessed be the God of our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us, right? Have blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. That He is the source. He is the ATM. He is the inheritance. He is the one to guide you and direct you. When we think about that for a moment, we need to realize that it's already been deposited on your behalf. It's already been given on your behalf. You need to know how you're going to get to heaven. The payment of your sin has already been deposited years ago on Calvary's tree. You want to be able to claim victory in your life? Realize that He didn't stay in the tomb but just a few days, and He walked out 3 days later, ascended 4 days, 40 days later, and is now sitting on the right hand of power, the hand of authority, the hand that is above all things, right? That's the name of Jesus Christ. And once we have established this mindset, once we have established that our eyes need to be open, the second thing we need to realize is our sight must change. Our sight must change. You know, this, I often thought about this, but not nearly as I do now with Leah. I was telling Keith a minute ago, you know, Oakley acting the way she did kind of got me fired up. Leah doing her thing is just what she does. But I thought about that just a couple of weeks ago. We were down in Hattiesburg, and their paternal grandparents have been supportive the whole time, and we don't mind them seeing the kids. And we went to the zoo, the Hattiesburg Zoo, and we were sitting there. We walked in. There's this monkey thing swinging from a branch. I don't know what it was. It looked like a monkey to me, but it wasn't called a monkey. And we look at Lee, and we say, hey, look at the monkey in its this direction. And she says, I see it. I thought to myself, same. Do you laugh or do you cry? But you know how many people in the Christian faith know what the gospel says and they say, I see it, and it's over here? Think about it. I remember we walked through there, we go to the giraffe. Maybe she can see the giraffe, and she probably did. But the best part of the trip, there's a little fox there, if you've ever been, in this little glass window by eye level to her, and she gets up to it, she turns her head where she can see a little bit peripherally, and that little dude jumped, and you'd have thought she was just going to have a panic attack because she saw that little guy, and she says back, ooh, I see it. And in that moment, that excitement of seeing that fox should be what it for us as Christians, that we know the Word, but when we finally realize the Word of God, and we accept the Word of God, it should allow us to pull back in excitement of the power of the gospel. It should allow us to realize that something's different, something's changed. And as Christians, our sight needs to change. As Christians, we need to see it the way that Christ wants us to see. Now, what does He want us to see? Verse 19, I'm glad that you asked. And what is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe? He wants you as a Christian to see the power in what we believe and understand the power in what we believe. So simply put, it's this, that God desires for you to see His power. Not the power of the preacher, not the power of the music minister, not the power of the youth pastor, not the power of the senior adult or the church. He wants you to see the power that's in His name, that it is great, that it is towards you, that it is for you. Verse 19 again, and what is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe according to the working of His power. He wants you to show you His strength. He wants you to realize that you can't do it on your own. He wants you to realize that all you have to do is look up. He wants you to realize that no matter what you say or what you think, that if your sight is not on Him, you're going to miss the mark. You're going to miss what He wants you to do. And what does He want you? He wants you to open your eyes. He wants you to see that you matter. He wants you to see that your life matters, that your marriage matters, that who you are matters. Look at what He continues in verse 20. Which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and set Him at His own right hand in heavenly places. Verse 21. For above all principality and power and might and dominion, here it is, this is where it gets really good, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in what that is to come. That's what he wants you to realize. So what does that mean for me and for you? If you'll throw back up verse 20 for just a second, Josh, for just a moment, if you will. If you look back at verse 20 of the gospel here, look at what it says. Which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead. So when he raised him from the dead, 3 days later, we call that Easter Sunday, and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. When our sights are changed, that means we are seeing his power. And what is that power? That power is this, that God wants you, to experience resurrection power. God wants you to experience resurrection power. The power that what? What we just read in verse 20. Raised him from the dead. The same power for you is, hey, I'm struggling with depression. I'm struggling with anxiety. I'm struggling with self-worth. I'm struggling with you filling the blank. You can be raised from the newness of life if you realize the power that's in the name of Jesus Christ. And Paul is trying to make it clear. You may say, well, you don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I'm facing. You don't know where my life's at. You don't know where my marriage is. You don't know what my kids are doing. Let me explain to you what resurrection power is. Resurrection power is a reversal of fortune. Resurrection power is a reversal of fortune. What that means is this. Before you got saved, you're living a life that shows that you're on the path to hell, that you are headed to hell, you are headed to separation from Christ for all of eternity. And in one moment, when you cried out to Christ and you believe that he died and you believe that he rose again and you believe Romans 5 verse 8 that he commended his love for us, that while we were yet sinners, he died for us, and you called upon the name of the Lord in Romans chapter 10, in that moment you experience resurrection power, where it is a reversal of fortune. If you're here this morning and you're on the path to hell and you don't know where you're going to spend eternity and you don't know for sure that you're going to go to a place called heaven, you can experience the power of the resurrection of God by experiencing the reversal of your own life, that you're on the path to hell, and by God's grace and the power of God's name, you're on the path to a place called heaven. I don't know about you, but that's a whole lot better than the fortune cookie. That's a whole lot better than what people may say or think or what we may allow us to go through. It's a 180-degree change in the other direction. What kind of power is this? Y'all remember the movie, Remember the Titans? Great movie. I'll probably be dreaming about old Blue doing up, down, so when I normally reference this movie. But they start singing in the locker room and talk about soul power. Y'all remember that, where it's African-Americans and whites in the room and they're merging there or coming together and nobody wants to be a part of it. And then they start going together as a team. They start functioning as a team. They start winning and doing big things as a team. That's the power that we have. That's the power of the gospel. The power that we're talking about, this resurrection power, is the power that takes dead people and makes them alive. This is the same power that takes the bad and makes it good. We can continue. The same power that allows defeat to become a victory, to take a loss and wind up with gain. It's a change in who you are. It's a change in how you view things. Now, this is going to happen when you experience a place called heaven and the glorified body's there and you're in the presence of Christ and you are praising him and adoring him and bowing before him and giving him what he deserves. But that doesn't mean you can't go ahead and do it right now. That doesn't mean you can't go ahead and live for him today, that you can't go ahead and say, I want what Christ has. Look again what it says in verse 20, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. Easter Sunday, you know, that's one of the Sundays that everybody shows. Praise God, I'm glad people do. But Easter Sunday is really every Sunday if you believe in the resurrected Jesus Christ. When we think about this, though, the book of Hebrews says that he is raised to the throne. He is raised to the higher place. Y'all remember last week we were talking about power and we were talking about the fountain of life and the river of life coming from an elevated position down through heaven. That elevated position is the throne of God. And so when Christ dies and he's buried and he raises again 3 days later for 40 days, the Bible tells us that he walks on the earth. And then after the 40 days, we call it the ascension, the Mount of Transfiguration, where he ascends into heaven and God the Father says, I want you to sit on my right, which is the authoritative hand. And I want you to sit there until I tell you it's time to go get your children. This is what the gospel calls the throne. And this is where Jesus Christ is sitting because he's in the ruling position. And he's going to remain in the ruling position until the Lord says, hey, go get your children. And then he's going to continue to reign. And in that moment, those who don't know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior are going to wish that they had knew Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. And so I tell you this, the euphemism that's used in the book of Hebrews of the heavenly places is carrying the idea that that's where we get our power from. We get our power from the one who is sitting on the throne. And the problem for so many of us is you're allowing yourself to sit on the throne of your life rather than allowing the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to sit on the throne of your life. And you wonder why nothing's working. And we wonder why we're struggling. And we're wondering what we're going to do. And Jesus tells us that we need to realize that Satan is going to try to deceive us. Satan is going to tell you that you don't matter. Satan is going to tell you that you don't matter in the eyes of God. That you can do this or you can do that. But the gospel says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 8, it says, "In being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death unto the cross." If he goes to the cross for you, the least you can do is go to the throne for him. If he goes to the cross, the least you can do is go to the throne. What does that mean? It simply says this, that he is willing to die for you, and we must be willing to put our faith and trust in him, which leads to our final point this morning. Our life must be redirected. Our life must be redirected. If you're sitting in here and you've tried everything else, I need you to listen to point number three. Hopefully you've listened to every point, but I need you to listen to point number three. For some folks, money's an issue. For some folks, money's not. For some folks, it doesn't matter. They can spend it. They can tap the card. They can do this, do that. Nothing matters. And for some of us, that's not exactly how we live. But when it comes to the riches of the glory of the inheritance of Christ, you have an all-access pass, right? You can go anywhere. You can go backstage. You can go to the front. You can go to the parking lot. You can do whatever you want to do. And when you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you have an all-access pass, which means this, that you can go boldly to the throne of God through the blood of Jesus Christ, that you don't have to come to me, that you don't have to go to a deacon, but you have an all-access pass. Look at what it says in Ephesians chapter 2. Beginning in verse 4, "But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love, wherewith he loved us." Verse 5, "Even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you are saved." Verse 6, "And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places," is that euphemism, "in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." Which means this, that when you accept Jesus as your Savior, you're functioning here, but you are living there. Understand what that means? That you died with Christ, that you were resurrected with Christ, that he is allowing you to sit with him. The Bible, we just read it, I didn't say it. The Bible says, and I quote, "seated with him." And that means that Paul is saying that we have been relocated spiritually, that our residence is in heaven, but we are here in this moment, that our life should be showing that we've been transformed, that our place of origin is now different, that we did die with him, we were raised with him, and we are seated with him. The problem is we're trying to live and function in the wrong location. We're trying to proclaim the power in the heavenly places, but live as the flesh. We're trying to say, I love the Lord, and I know that he died for me, but we're not living a life that shows that we love the Lord and know that he died for me. And that's where we as Christians begin to teeter in the wrong direction. A lost person should live like a lost person. The problem is when a saved person lives like a lost person. And there are times we've all done it. It's a battle every single day as a Christian as whether or not you're going to allow Satan to take your joy or take your happiness or take your motives and do what he wants to do rather than what God wants you to do. And so if you're here this morning and you've tried everything, you're operating in the wrong location, you need to accept the right location and understand the authority that's found in Christ. And that authority that's found in Christ is when you accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior and you realize that you're seated with Him in heavenly places, and that's what Christ does. He has the authority to do big things. Or it could be said this way, authority works where Jesus rules. Authority works where Jesus rules. You're in your life. And Jesus is not the Lord of your life. And you're wondering why you can't shake the addiction. You're wondering why you can't break the chain. It's hard for Jesus' authority to work when you're not allowing Him to rule your life. But when you allow Him to rule your life, then you can say, as Philippians says, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. At the name of Jesus, you can say, I'm not identified as a homosexual. I'm not identified as an adulterer. I'm not identified as an alcoholic. I'm not identified as you fill in the blank. I'm identified as a child of the King, forgiven through the power and the gospel of the blood of Jesus Christ. What do we do as we wrap this up? It means simply this. For us to experience the power, for us to experience the resurrected power, we must put ourselves under the feet of Jesus. We will not experience the power of God. You will not experience the power of God until we place ourselves under the feet of Jesus. You have to make the decision. It's called free will. It's not that God sends people to hell and God sends people to heaven. If someone goes to hell, it's because they deny that Jesus Christ died for them, rose again, and wants to forgive their sins. It's not that God sits up there in His heavenly places and says, I'm going to die for this one, but I'm not going to die for that one. And if you listen to somebody who preaches that stuff, you need to find somebody else to listen to. Because the Bible simply tells us that we will experience the power of God when we say to ourselves, I cannot do this on our own. I'm going to place myself under the authority of God, the control of God, and the rule of God. And if you are not under His rule, if you have not placed yourself under the feet of Jesus, you're not going to receive His information. In other words, the natural is not going to meet the supernatural until you realize something in the middle has to change, and that middle is your life, your direction, your goals, the lordship of Christ. Let me close with Romans chapter 14, if I may, beginning in verse 7. It says this, for none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. Verse 8, for whether we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. We are the Lord's. So if we live or we die, we are the Lord's. Verse 9, for to this end Christ both died and rose and revived that he might be Lord both the living and the dead. In other words, there is no greater name than the name of Jesus. There's no way you're going to win in life apart from Jesus. There's no way you're going to experience your self-worth apart from Jesus. There's no way that you're going to understand the direction of your life and the side of your life and the opening of your lives apart from Jesus. And so let me leave you with this one statement, and it simply says this, we will not experience heaven until we're under the lordship of Jesus Christ. The only way you're going to heaven, my friend, is that you've confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And if you think there's any other way, I just read that person's lips. You are wrong. She said it. I just happened to see it. So I want to leave you with this. If you don't know where you're going, today's the day. If you want to be a part of a church that loves God and loves people, we'd love to have you. If you're a believer that is struggling in life and you need redirecting, that's found in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. Let me give you the opportunity to make it right this morning if you want to by putting your faith and trust in Jesus or making whatever decision needs to be made for the glory of the Lord. Let's pray together during our time of invitation. Lord, we come to you and we thank you for the power of the gospel. And Lord, we ask that you'll guide our lives and direct our lives in a mighty way. Lord, we ask that you'll go before us, Lord, that if there's anyone here today that doesn't know you as their Lord and Savior, today's the day of salvation. Lord, if there are folks that have been saved and are off track and needs to realign themselves with you, Lord, I pray today's that day. If there are folks that want to be a part of this church that's been visiting for a long time and want to make that decision, I pray today is the day. But Lord, during our time here, during our time of invitation, probably the most important time of any service, Lord, I ask for your spirit to move. I pray you'll ban Satan from this place, that the only name that matters that's ringing true in the ears and the hearts of the people in the building is the name of Jesus Christ. We love you and we praise you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we sing.
Yeah.
you'll be seated for a moment. I'll let you out 3 weeks in a row early, and I'm going to get it back right here. But these are good reasons. If you two make your way up, just stand right here, please. Preston McCarty, Miss Sarah Pace, I met with them this week, and they've accepted Christ as their Savior and wants to be baptized. He's ultimately coming to rededicate. She's been saved, but hasn't been baptized and wants to be a part of our church. And so we're excited for their decision. Pray the Lord to continue to bless them. He is the son of Robbie and Melissa McCarty, who have been here for quite some time now. So we're thankful for their decision. So technically, she does need a welcome from Flowood Baptist Church, and he's been here. He's just going to get it right, and I'm thankful for his decision to do that. Will you give them a warm Flowood welcome this morning? All right. All right. If you'll just stay right here. Come on, pal. Jacob Mooney here. I'm going to show you how the Lord works. And last night, a couple of weeks ago, his parents joined over here to my left, and we met with them last night over dinner and began to talk about praying for this young man's salvation and for God to work in his life. And the Lord moved. I'm going to put you on the spot. I'm going to make you talk. Just stay with me. The Lord moved during Sunday school, and his mom had started having a conversation in the hallway or on the sidewalk. I called him in the office, and he said, "Look, man, I don't know where I'm going." And I said, "You need to listen to this message because it's going to hit you right between the eyes." And literally, not physically, guys, spiritually speaking. And he's coming today and putting his trust in Jesus Christ. And don't ever stop praying for your kids, right? Don't stop praying. And so he's coming. We're proud of you, and we're going to be meeting with him in the upcoming days. But he's coming as a new believer, putting his faith in Christ, following baptism when the time comes. Mr. Jacob Moon, will you give him a warm Flowood welcome as well? All right. All right, so this family has been around for quite some time. Her dad, Miss Carrie's husband, I met him playing golf. Imagine that, right? And they came and dedicated this little one to the Lord a long time ago. They've been out of church. They're back in church, and the Lord's working in their life and their marriage, and Amelia here is coming and wanting to put her faith and trust in Jesus Christ as well. And so the gospel's still working. The gospel's still moving, and people are still being saved, blessed with the power in the name of Jesus Christ. So she's coming as well, putting her faith and trust in Christ. We're following believers' baptism. She walked up. She's like, "I don't know what to do." And so I ask her the basic questions, and we overcomplicate it sometimes, and sometimes all we got to do is change our sight line, and for that we're thankful. So she's coming and wants to be saved and accept the Christ or Savior following baptism as well. Will you give her a warm Flowood welcome? All right. All right. I know there's a meeting for the fall festival, but I'm going to ask if you two guys would make your way up here, and if Miss Carrie, if you'll make your way. I'm going to ask them to be in the back. If you have a few moments to give them the right hand of Christian fellowship on the way out, I would appreciate that very much as we rally aside these young folks and the decision that they're making. Brother Keith.